So, welcome to my second presentation at Evo Mozart for today. The topic is a fusion of deep and shallow learning to predict genres based on instrument and timbre features. And this is a joint work with Benedikt Adrian and Yuri Kuzmich. Okay, so what is music genre recognition? So basically, it's one of the most prominent applications in music information retrieval. So already in 2012, more than 400 related studies were referred. And until now, there still exist many old and new proposals which deal with genre recognition. So the first of the approaches are usually based on manually engineered features. So we start with some data source, typically audio signal in earlier works, but also we can start with MIDI annotations or lyrics or album covers and so on. And what we want to have at the end is a music genre or music style, or maybe some other high level category like mood, emotion, and so on. And what is done in between? We have to apply some domain transforms, so typically Fourier transform, or we can extract Mel spectrum, apply autocorrelation, phase domain, and so on. Then we extract some features like chroma, Mel frequency capsule coefficients. We can also try to extract timbral descriptors, instruments. Then we process these features, for example, normalizing them or aggregating some statistics along classification windows. And then we classify the classification windows using shallow methods like random forest or support vector machines and so on. Recently, deep neural networks were proposed also for music genre recognition, and they became also very successful. So here, this algorithm chain looks a bit different. So we start with some data source, and again, we need some transform to provide features or some domain space as input for the neural network. And also we want to predict genre styles and so on. And we have some training, but what is happens in between is done completely by the network. So it extrains some features, which are then transformed to some mid-level characteristics, using neuron weights, and then all this processing is done in the black box of the network. So my question here is deep learning always the better choice? So there exist no free lunch theorems, and they claim that any two algorithms are equivalent when their performance is averaged across all possible problems. So it means when algorithm A performs better than B, then maybe we'll have some problems where B performs better than E. And there are very different problems also for genre recognition. There are some genres which are very good defined and some very complicated. Sometimes we have small training set. Sometimes we have large training set. We have different features. So I think it's not a good idea to say always deep learning is a better choice. In particular, there exist several drawbacks of deep neural networks. They are not always drawbacks. There exist sometimes all good approaches to deal with them, but still we have to think about them. For example, we have a very huge number of parameters to learn. So it means it's easier to overfit against training data. If we have some thousands or even hundreds of thousands of parameters, and we have a rather small training set, or even with a large training set, we have so many weights, so it's possible to overfit. And in particular for small training sets, why is it interesting? Because if you want to define a music personal category like genre or style, it is better for us to select a couple of music tracks which belong to this genre and then a couple of tracks which are not belonging to this genre, and then the black box, the algorithm should learn it. So we want maybe to use only small training sets, then it's not so easy with deep neural networks. Then we have poor interpretability. That's also an issue. So it's not very easy to understand what happens in this network. So there exist some good approaches for image recognition, but if you work with, for example, with Mel spectrum, it's not so easy to understand what happens there. For training, often a large amount of time is required. And even with graphical processing units, we should think about environmental costs. So for example, a training of a large neural network and the application of this network can have some environmental impact. However, don't want to say that deep learning is not good for genre recognition, but we think about how can we combine both worlds. So maybe we can try to predict something using deep neural networks, but also try to use shallow methods. How can be that done? Yeah, we can try to predict some mid-level features using deep neural networks, and then use rather simple models to predict genres. So which features can be used as mid-level characteristics? For instance, we can start with instruments because they are rather important for genre recognition. Here there are some examples. Basically, instruments can correlate with moods and emotions, and so they're rather important for genres. So here are some examples for instruments. I hope you can hear them. So by selection of an instrument or different number of instruments for so-called instrument texture, we can quite strongly define a genre or music style. Instrument recognition was done with traditional features, but also with CNNs. So for example, here, there are references to two works which apply convolutional neural networks for recognition of instruments. In particular, this work was presented at EBU-MUSE Art last year. But what was not very often applied is the usage of this instrument features for genre recognition. So for example, there was one work where instrument-related features after source separation were applied for genre recognition. And also in our previous work, some approximative features for instrumental texture were used also for prediction of genres. So in this study, we use both approaches, this CNN and our approximative features as a baseline to compare with. And we want to predict instruments and then predict genres. So this is a complete overview of our framework, which should be done in future. So we have audio signals and we have some deep classifiers, which can be applied only once for each music track. So we have some instruments, harmonic properties, melodic properties, dynamic properties, maybe time structure. And then we can use shallow classifiers. For instance, it is even possible to apply some fuzzy rule classifiers, which are really very comprehensible. And these shallow classifiers can predict genre styles, emotions, but also composer stacks, and so on. And what is also good is that if we extract such mid-level complex characteristics like instruments, we can do this only once per music track. But if a listener will try to define new styles and personal preferences over and over again, then we can use only shallow methods. So it's, we can save some time for training and also classification. So how does it work? So the convolutional network-based features I used from previous work, which was also adjusted during master thesis, which was supervised by myself. So these are the references. So the first initial work presented at the in Hahn, and then in the work from Benedict Adrian. And the architecture of the network can be very easily, very simply presented if we assign some letters to layers, convolutional layer like C, batch normalization D, and so on. We have max pooling, dropout, global max pooling, fully connected. So this is the overall network architecture. This net was, however, for this study was trained with a new data set. So from the previous work, we had 51 different instruments, so individual samples from complete Ultimate collection, and this so samples were mixed. So first, I have created a data set of 1,000 soul samples, then data set with mixes of 2 samples, then 3, 4, and 5 samples. And the prediction goal, or the training goal for the CNN, was not to predict whether an instrument occurs, but rather to measure the relative share of energy of the instrument which contributes to the mix. Two different CNN features are used here. So first one, the CNN, which was trained with all mixes. Then we have predictions for 51 instruments, but then the predictions are aggregated over classification windows. So it means we have a mean value and standard deviation for this classification window, leading to a number of dimension equal to 102. And then we have an ensemble of CNN features. So they are trained for 1,000 source samples, 1,002 sample mixes, and so on. So in that case, we have 612 different dimensions. The first baseline is from previous work. So here I use approximative features. So this study was presented last year at a CEC conference. Here, very briefly, I use evolutionary optimization of individual sample mixes to approximate some unknown recordings. So here, if you have some unknown recording like this one, so please take care of this last chord, so it will be approximated. Then we can try to create different approximations. For instance, the first approximation uses the same instruments and the same pitches, but not the same instrument bodies as in the original recording for the last chord. And this is an approximation where the violin is switched to piano. And here you can see in the chroma domains, so this is a pitch class profile with individual amplitudes of half tones, that if we switch to piano, there are some differences. For example, here for E, the strength is not very large. Here is also not very large, but here's larger. So it's a bit more different. And the hope in that work was that if we use a proper approximation with the same instruments, but other instrument bodies, then in some feature domain, like pitch class profile or male spectrum or other domain, the distance between the chord to approximate and the approximation will be lower if this approximation will have the perfect instruments. So this task was very hard, and the performance for instrument recognition was not very good, but it was still very much better than random. But these features were quite good for genre recognition. So that's why I selected them also as a baseline. And here two feature sets I used. One's all approximative features here, which leads to 408 dimensions. And then dominance ranks of instruments, 102 dimensions. So in that case, all instruments were sorted according to the similarity to unknown recording. For example, if violin had the highest probability to occur in the recording from this approximative feature, then it received first the rank one. And then the next instrument receives the rank two, three, and so on. And then it was normalized to values between 0 and 1. The final baseline, the second baseline, is contains various timbral descriptors, which are listed here in this table. So like male frequency capital coefficients and spectral characteristics, zero crossing rate, and so on. And the overall number of dimensions was here 96. So coming to experiments, the data set used is 1,517, so it's quite a good data set because it's publicly available, but it has also a large number of different music tracks. That's more than 1,000. And also more than 1,000 even after the application of artist filter, because in the original data set, I think there are somewhat about 3,000 tracks, but some of the tracks belong to the same interpret. So after the application of artist filter, we had 1,674 tracks remaining. And the genres are also very interesting because some of them are rather closely related, like alternative and punk against rock and pop. But some of the genres are really hard to predict, like soundtracks and more world music. So they contain very, very different music. For the classification, stratified tenfold cross-validation was applied. So I use here balanced training sets for a better comparison across genres. All training sets have the same size. So it means, for example, from the classical music, there was not so much data. That's why this rather small number, 36 positive tracks, 36 negative tracks. But it is still close to a real world situation, because if we want to define a personal category or genre, typically, as I said before, we don't want to label a very large number of different tracks. So then we have 10 partitions. Yeah, one partition, we select then a training set using 72 tracks which are well balanced, and then we select from the test partition 160 tracks, and this test set is not balanced anymore. But it's not a problem because for validation we estimate balanced classification error, so which basically measures the error for positive and negative tracks. It's a binary classification, and two different methods are applied here: it's a random forest with 200 trees and linear support vector machine. So now coming to results, so quite a large table. So first of all, I'll explain it. So here we have 19 different genres. Then we have here individual feature groups, so CNN and CNN ensemble features, then approximative features ranked, approximative features all, and timbre baseline. And after this first experiment, the second experiment, which was conducted here, yeah, I have used combined feature groups. So for instance, here, CNN features together with timbre features, CNN with approximative features, approximative with timbre features, and then all of them together. Then the bold numbers correspond to the best error. So we want to reduce, the smaller values are better for individual feature groups for each genre. And then for combined feature groups also, it's marked with a bold font, and the underlined numbers correspond to error values which were the very best for each genre. So let us look first at individual feature groups. So here we can see that the CNN features perform quite good. So for 11 of all genres, the best results were achieved with these features. And for the remaining, so the approximative features did not perform very good. So they were best only for children's genre, and timbral descriptors, however, were quite good for the remaining for different genres. So this are the results with random forest. Then if we look at combined feature groups again, so here for a larger part of this combinations, CNN features contributed to them. Also basically to here together with timbre, it performed at best, or together with approximative features, or with all groups together. So now if we look to overall results, in particular compared to baseline, so here this gray rectangles show the results without CNN features. We can see that only for six genres, the results were better without CNN instrument features. So here, 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 and here. And also what you can see, for example, here, this both genres like soundtracks and more and world music are very roughly defined. So it's rather hard to make predictions based on instruments here anyway. And another example for maybe for a poor choice of a category is this comedy and spoken word. So it's also not really interesting music genre. Here, this combination performed at best without CNN features. Yes, and classical was a rather simple, maybe easier to distinguish. So that was also the category where the CNN-based features did not contribute to the best sets. Here, the results for support vector machines, again, for individual feature groups, it looks very similar. So here, again, for 11 of all genres, CNN-based features performed better, contributed to smaller errors. And for combined feature groups, it looks even better. So here we have only one genre, it's folk music. So it's also now also used with CNN features, so it's even better. So without CNN features, even no genre with the smallest error. And if you look to the ever best results, so we have only one genre where for the baseline, where CNN features were did not contribute to the best results, and it's again this complex category of soundtracks and more. Okay, so coming to conclusions, in this work, we have proposed a combination of deep and shallow learning for genre recognition. For mid-level semantic properties, our idea is to use convolutional neural networks for general deep learning. And this study can be also considered as a preliminary experiment. So here we use only instruments, and surely it will make sense in future to extract also other mid-level characteristics, in particular characteristics which with some relation to music theory, like harmonic properties, melodic properties, and so on. So then on the other side, we can use shallow models or other classifiers which are even more interpretable. For instance, random forest is maybe not always very interpretable because we have an ensemble of a large number of different trees. So here we can consider maybe later also to apply individual decision trees or fuzzy rule classifiers so that this black box models can be better understood. And the results were quite good. So the CNN-based features contributed to smaller errors for 11 of 19 genres. And as for the best combined feature sets for 13 of 19 genres, using random forest and 18 of 19 with support vector machines. And another comparison which was done here, so even if for each genre, if we use the ever best model from both random forest and SVM, this model contains CNN-based features for 17 of 19 genres. The future work should include also further optimization of neural networks, in particular with regard to their robustness. As I also said, more mid-level semantic features, but also the application of feature selection, because, for example, using this combined feature sets, sometimes, as in my previous talk, if you use full feature sets, large feature sets, the errors can even increase. So, and with more features, it will make definitely more sense to select some of them. So thank you for your attention, and now there's some time for questions.